begin chatting, so if you'd like to take a seat here again, you're welcome to, or in the house. My name is Sammy Cannell, and I'm the Associate Director of In the Body of the World. I'm so excited to be here today with these two amazing women. Sheree Henderson is a cancer survivor who is a doctoral student at Columbia University, where she also received her master's in narrative medicine. And Sandra Spannan is currently beating stage 4 colon cancer and is a performer and a painter and an owner of her own company focused on painting. And I'm so excited to talk about what resonated for you in seeing the piece. I know, Sandra, you were here opening night, and I'm sure you just saw it for the first time tonight. And I'm wondering if you could just talk about what resonated for you, moments that stuck out to you, or parts of the piece that were particularly relatable.
Hi, everybody. So yeah, I actually didn't see the play tonight just because I saw it at opening night, and there's so much that I can relate to that it just was a little emotionally overwhelming, and I wanted to be able to talk tonight instead of just sitting here sobbing. So I'm okay now because I didn't see the last 10 minutes of the play. That really hit me when the stage opened, and to me it was like a heart-opening, wrenching moment to see the garden and to just have all this information and emotion inside of me coming out. And there's so many different things I can relate to because I've been, you know, fighting this battle of stage 4 cancer. It's been in 6 different organs. I'm starting radiation again on Monday. I've been having, I don't even know, over 50 rounds of chemo at this point. I have my port, which I'm showing everybody with pride because it's like, it's a three-dimensional tattoo that's kind of cool because it's really badass. I also lost my mom. We were fighting this battle together, which was a whole new mom-daughter relationship, and she lost the battle, and that was really hard, and to hear her go through something similar was very astounding to see. And besides all the other little things, I had a really handsome surgeon that I had a crush on. At one point, actually, he said kind of casually, like, yeah, we should have a DMT after you finish with this. And I had a lot of witnesses, some of them in this room, that's heard him say that. And I still count on this at one point in my life because he's very handsome. And he saved my life besides many, many other people. There's so many other details, like working. I never stopped working. I really think that getting up in the morning and having the power and energy and the hope to continue was due to being a mom, having 2 children, teenage daughters, young teenage daughters, and to have a business with 12 employees, only 2 of them are men, so I feel very responsible for those artists as well. And if I would have been just by myself without having a job that I'm really passionate about, I don't think I would still be here, to be honest, you know, because it takes so much energy and so much creative energy and belief and hope and strength to fight every day, to be poked, you know, to be cut open, to be touched all the time by strangers. So the comparison to rape, I haven't been raped, that's one thing I can't relate to, but it is a very strong comparison and very brave comparison, but it's a true comparison. It really feels like that on a daily basis, that your body's been invaded, that you can't sleep at night, that you're constantly facing death. On the other side, I also get a lot of power out of that. I've been doing things I never did before. Having the gun pointed to your head like this makes you just do stuff that you always delay. You know, you can't be a procrastinator anymore. I fired my husband throughout this whole thing. I got divorced. I fired my first oncologist. I also fired or moved the hospital. So that's another similar thing because I've never really been sick, so I always just got doctors and everybody that tells you what to do. They're the heroes, they know what they're doing. And throughout this whole journey, I really realized I have to be my own self, you know, my advocate, and do research and fight for my own self. And I've been doing that, and that's one thing that, you know, having the gun to your head makes you do those things and kind of wake up and be really, really present with every moment that you've been given. And also to not fight this fight alone. That's why I love that she's doing this play and wrote the book, because I know people that have Lyme disease or cancer that are in the closet. And I've been very open about my disease and to my clients, to everybody. I post disgusting pictures on my Instagram with like needles tucking out or like stuff, just because I feel, to me, especially being alone at night, sometimes even reading a reaction of somebody to a post that I did helps. And it's almost like sharing the pain with everybody and making everybody take part of it, if they want to or not, you know, but just to not be alone. And I really strongly advocate everybody that is in the closet about their diseases to come out and to share their pain. Because in me doing this, I had a lot of responses from people on Facebook where that would be completely alone. And so that's something I feel really strong about, and I love that she's been doing this, you know, for that very reason. So thank you.
Thank you. I don't know if I have a lot to add to that. No, but you mentioned a moment that really resonated with me also, which was the moment with Dr. Hanson where he comes around the side of the bed and she has the lion out. That's really all it takes, right? And so you mentioned I got my master's in a program called narrative medicine at Columbia, and we talk a lot about the relationship between the clinician and the patient and the power that's going on there. And she, I've mentioned that in her play as well, right? When I think her sister Lou comes and Lou is sitting in the chair and she's on the bed and there's a power relationship there. And as a patient, you do feel so vulnerable, your bodily being poked at, as you said. And so things that we can do to advocate for awareness even of that feeling of what it's like to be the patient, I think is really important.
In relation to talking about those experiences, I'm wondering if seeing art that talks about cancer, what role that has played in your respective journeys with the disease, and how this play or other works of art about cancer have played into your experience?
I feel like when I was diagnosed in 2001, so this is a long time in the past, I had rectal cancer, so which is part of the colorectal family of cancers. I read everything I could get my hands on because I'm stealing someone else's line here. But when I was diagnosed, I think when other people were diagnosed with something with a serious illness, you sort of, for me, it came out of nowhere. I was in my early 30s. I had a 2-year-old son. This is not on my radar, and I didn't know how to be a cancer patient. What am I supposed to do with this? And so, for me, art was a way to figure out how to navigate this experience.
Yeah, there's one book that I really love. It's, I don't know if I would call it art, it's more a research book, Radical Remission, that I found a lot of hope in. And also doing my own art, you know, and I started actually, which is another interesting aspect, in the last 3 years, I got diagnosed 3 years ago, my company's income kind of doubled because I had to stop micromanaging. I had to like step back and, you know, be the director from the chemo chair, and it actually really helped the business, which is interesting. I should start a little seminar about that. but just to be a good leader, you know, and to really make wise decisions and to focus more on the creative aspect of my work, or to say no to jobs that I'm not interested in creatively, which I never dared do before, or to me to pick my clients rather than them picking me. All those decisions I made in the last 3 years, which I should have made 20 years ago, you know, because it led to more success, and it led me to open up a shop that deals with gold leaf items, and the whole theme of that those products. They're all done by women, local artists, and they all have the theme of fighting the Me Too movement, you know, like all of that kind of, it all happened at the same time, Trump appearing, and every morning I would wake up and be like, this is a nightmare, I have cancer, my mom died, and Trump is elected. Like, it just, I still wake up that way every day, thinking this is a dream, you know. I don't really have cancer, he's not really the president. But all that kind of came together. So creatively, I can't recall another book or play right now, but for myself, I have to say that just making something with my hand and leaving something behind, you know, is very important.
In terms of this play, I know you've both read the book, and I believe you teach the book. I'm wondering if you could talk about the differences in the experience for you of reading it and then seeing it on stage, and how that experience changed it at all.
Again, the reading the book was just, you know, when you read a book, you get interrupted by your kids, or you fall asleep while you're reading, you know. To me, this was just a really heavy dose of seeing herself speaking, and it just brought up a lot of emotion. So it was much more emotional when I read the book than when I read the book. But there are a lot of beautiful details in the book that you don't hear on the play. So I would really recommend for everybody to read the book, because there's a lot of little stories that are very cool.
And I realize we should say, for anyone who doesn't know, the play is based on Eve's memoir, In the Body of the World, this by the same title. But it's just quite a bit longer and includes quite a bit more, and is not on stage.
Yeah, I would say they're two different experiences. So you get different things out of reading than seeing. And I think they're both equally powerful, just in different ways. For me, the reading is very immersive. There's a conversation between me and the author, where here I'm more immersed in the experience. So I think not one is better than the other, they're just different.
I want to make sure we get to some of your questions. If you could speak loudly, because we have a big room, and then I will repeat your question so that everybody can hear it before they answer. The question was about how you deal with these experiences vis-a-vis your children, and how much you tell them or don't tell them.
My son was 2, so he didn't have a lot of awareness as a 2-year-old. But I do volunteer at Memorial Sloan Kettering, which didn't get the greatest rep in this show, but did okay by me. And that's a question that comes up a lot, because I get matched as a patient-to-patient volunteer with people who are also parents. And I think you let the child guide you. Let them ask the questions that they want to know the answer to. Give them a little bit, see how much more they want. But I don't, my son, it was more like the book Curious George Goes to the Hospital was the book that we read to him, and Mommy's going to the hospital, and we let him come and visit and use the little gadget that raises the bed up and down, which he thought was way cool. Although I did very much relate to that moment also. In fact, the doctor or the nurse asked me, why are you pushing the button so much? And I thought, well, I guess because I'm in pain. But do you have other insights on the children?
Well, my kids were like in a very vulnerable age. You know, they were 8 and 7 and 10, no, 7 and 9 when I got diagnosed. And so they knew enough. You couldn't fool them anymore, you know. And they're very smart. They knew what was going on. But we still had a lot of help from the hospital and social workers, you know, where we really prepared the talk. And so every time I say, I have to talk to you guys, they freak out because they're so paranoid that it's another talk again. But also now my older daughter, she's 13 and a half now, and she missed 4 months of school this year due to heavy duty depression and anxiety. And partly because it's what she's going through, but I think a lot of the time when she talks to a therapist, and like, you know, we're in New York, so we have family therapy and CBT therapy and psychiatrists and everybody involved, but it takes a village to get, and there's a lot of people here in the audience, Kim, who is a director for YDC, my kids are in that group, it's a modern dance group that has helped them so much. They've been actually working through art, right, through this whole, these past 3 years, just expressing themselves in dance and talking about it on a bi-weekly base, every week, twice, and so I push them to be open about what was going on with their friends and in the group. And yeah, I really believe it takes a village to raise a child, but also to have cancer and to go through that, you know?
Other questions?
Oh, I'm sorry, you're raising your
hand. Yes. The question was about narrative medicine, that program, and also communications, and whether or not that's being taught to medical students.
So I didn't actually read what you read, but my master's is in narrative medicine, and now I'm getting a PhD in communications, which may be what you're, and communications can mean anything. So I'm using communications to look at media and health care. As far as whether it's being taught to medical students, absolutely yes. This program was born in the Columbia University Medical Center. A lot of people who are getting, and so everyone at the medical center does do a narrative medicine elective. And then as far as the students in the master's program, probably about half are planning to go to medical school or are in medical school and taking a gap year type thing, or they're practicing clinician of some sort and doing this program also. So yes, and it's not just at Columbia, it's the health humanities as a broader field is also something that's really taking hold across the country. There are a lot of undergraduate degrees now in some type of health humanities, and in fact, at Vanderbilt, which has also a very strong program, they found that the students who are doing that type of a program as opposed to a typical pre-med program, actually getting into medical school at higher rates because medical schools are starting to look for students who have these tools that equip them for the hard decisions and things they're going to face as doctors.
Well, I wish the first doctor that told me that I have cancer would have come to your class. yeah, I mean, I'm from Germany, so this is not my first language. So the term bedside manners, I never heard of that before, and I didn't know what it means until I experienced very bad bedside manners. You know, and I think that that's a huge, as Eve mentioned, if somebody just does the simplest small things to just respect you as a human being, you know, that is facing, you know, the new knowledge that you face death, you know, it's such a profound moment that I will never forget in my life what this person said to me, you know, and how he said it, and then he wouldn't wait for my then husband to come back from parking the car to tell me just because he was on a lunch break, you know. It's those moments that you'll never forget, and they just brand it in your deepest soul, you know.
And unfortunately, every patient has that story, right?
I'm hoping for the next generation to teach.
Me too. Yes.
In March, I'll be 28 years post-cancer. And I used to be terrified that the cancer would kill me. Now, I have a child that I'm 50 years older, that I adopted. So I'm 50 years older than her. So I think about age all the time and this crazy calculus of being so much older than her. Mm. I'm wondering, when you're in both cases, how do you bridge the difference between focusing on, I want to live as long as I can, to I want to live in the present and be present for my kid? Right? I mean, you have this clear battle. You have to do the chemo. You have to do all that kind of stuff. But you know, I'm realizing like I could be so focused on the future and miss the present. And I think that cancer can help one deal with the present. Maybe you can speak to that.
The question was about the struggle between longevity and being present.
It's that's a very good question, because I battle that every day. Like, I love riding motorcycles, for example, and those are the things that I want to do more now, knowing that, you know, not knowing how much longer I live. I love to travel. I've traveled to like 6-7 different countries just in the last year for my work and pleasure, but sometimes I leave my kids behind, you know, and a lot of times I felt bad about it. At the same time, you know, I also feel like I want to live my life as full as possible. And yes, I do so many alternative treatments on top of the chemo and radiation and surgeries that take a lot of time. You know, I'm spending so much time in the hospital, and now she's allowed, my 13-year-old is now allowed to come to the chemo with me, because before she wasn't allowed in those rooms. And I'm slowly bringing them more into my other world, you know, my other full-time job. And it's given them a lot of compassion, you know, when I'm gone so much. And I think it was great, the nurses and everybody, you know, everybody's like, hey, Sandra. It's like a club that I don't really want to be known at, but my girls saw how everybody knew me there, how, and they kept telling her, oh, she's a troop, oh my God, your mom, you know, she wouldn't even be here anymore. And because, as I said, my cancer was very advanced, and even my first doctor didn't really believe that I would still be here now. And so to keep that away from the kids at the same time, to be open and honest and transparent, like, I don't want to lie to my daughters, and they're both old enough to know a lot. Like, I wanted to bring them here, but then I decided that was a little much. You know, like, you have to kind of make these daily decisions, I think, as you go, just as we do with anything as a parent.
I don't know if I can speak to that directly. I will say I was a journalist at the time that I was diagnosed. I had been the editor of my fifth grade newspaper. I was the editor of my high school newspaper. I majored in journalism in college. That was my thing. And I realized that I had kind of burned out of it. And I think, it sounds really cliche, but I was very aware of my time and decided to leave this profession that really defined me. You know, and I really didn't want cancer to become my identity. I was a journalist. In fact, working through my chemo, I don't know if you found this, was extremely important to me. It had another role in my life that wasn't being a cancer patient, but was being something else. So I guess in that sense, I don't know if that really answers your question, but it did change the way I looked at realizing that my time ahead was not was finite, and that I did want to make sure that I used what was now and was doing what I wanted to do.
We'll do one more. Yes.
Yes.
I know that you talked about your lives. You have children to look for. You have jobs to look for. You had lives. You had things going on. You had every reason that you want to live for these other things. But at some point, did you ever feel just absolutely that this is me, I'm alone, never mind what I'm living for, maybe I just don't want to fight? So what did you do if it happened that you had these awfully dark moments that said, it's okay, I can't face it, and I'm okay with that, and what I've had so far has been good enough. Thank you very much, and good night, ladies and gentlemen. So how did that happen to you, and if so, how did you?
The question was about the desire to more or less give up, and whether or not you encountered that, and what that was.
For me, actually, I did not reach that stage, but I had the revelation. I realized that I hadn't reached that stage when I did a writing group with other young adult cancer survivors, and another person expressed that that she really wasn't sure, and that's when I realized that this is going to make me a little teary. I had a 3-year-old, at that point, my son was 3 or 4, and he was absolutely the reason I wanted to see him through.
Sorry.
Don't apologize.
Okay, now you made it happen. We both teared up here. I don't know. Yeah. I think I have that moment every day, to be honest. I do. So there's different ways to deal with it, you know, when you have that moment. And I've never been a suicidal person. I've always been attracted to the manic depressive man in my life. I don't know why, but and I never understood why anybody would want to kill themselves, you know. So I've been always attracted to the dark side, but I never have been that person. And to have these thoughts is terrible. And to just want to give up, I could really say I have that thought at least once a day. And you know, I try to be really spiritual. That's another thing. I've been in India many times before I even had cancer. I stayed in ashrams. I have a Indian spiritual teacher. So I go there. I look at my kids, you know. I go there. I just look at all the things why I still have to be here. I'm currently shopping for a new motorcycle. And also what I did is actually when my cancer came back, it was a really hard year, 2 years, a year and a half ago. My mom was diagnosed with before me. Both of our cancers had come back, and we found out about it in the same week. And during that year, two other really close friends of mine died due to cancer. And I was just like, okay, I'm next. You know, I prepared everything. I did everything the doctors even in the beginning told me to do. I had my will prepared. Everything was ready. And then I started going to these healer sessions, also part of Colombia. This healer was part of a Colombia healer student group. You know, really turned me around in lots of different ways. And I'm happy to talk to anybody about this. There's different methods, therapeutical methods. And it really changed something for me. I think the most important thing to beat this cancer is to be closer to your instinct, to trust your instinct. You become almost like an animal, you know, like it's about death or life. And so you get so close. I always said that as a joke. I've done so many stays in the ashram in India and meditation and yoga and this and that. Being faced with this illness really forces you to become as spiritual as you can get. It's almost like an animal reaction, an instinct reaction. And I do daily meditations. I have my mantras in my head, or a photograph of my daughters, or of my spiritual teacher, whatever it takes, even if it's an instinct or a sage, or you just use all the tools you can get, you know, to go through your day.
Thank you both so, so very much for being here.